Welcome to Smart News Digital, July 24, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. The first article is India drops 3 ranks in A.T. Kearney FDI Confidence Index. So what the news is, India ranks 11th in the 2018 FDI Confidence Index. Before it was like securing 8th rank in 2017 and 9th in 2016. So who is this A.T. Kearney, which is an American global management consulting firm? What it does actually is it tracks the performance of the FDI inflows of each and every country. It also tracks the political, social and regulatory flows of the FDI in each and every country. And it also reveals that how each and every country is globally connected in terms of trade relationship. The report said mainly two things. One is why the rank of India comes down from the 8th rank or 9th rank to 11th rank. So the major reason for this rank coming down is because of the nationwide goods and services tax implementation by the government, which faces severe implementation challenges, as well as the 2016 demonetization initiative, which also disrupts the normal functioning of the economy. Or these two could be the major reasons for why the investors actually deterred to come and invest in the Indian economy. So this is what the report suggests, why the rank comes down. But at the same time, we are still maintaining in the top 15. So which indicates that there might be some reforms which could be taken by the government, which helps the Indian economy to be still maintaining in this top 15. So what are those things in the sense? The elimination of the FIPB, which is the Foreign Investment Promotion Board, and as well as the liberalizing the FDI limits in terms of certain key sectors such as aviation or retail, as well as some other key sectors. So these two things could lead to the maintenance of India's high ranking in terms of FDI attractiveness. So, but recently the potential investors who are coming to India might be cautious or might be careful in investing because of the two major things. One is China's presidential term limit extension, as well as India's upcoming general elections. So these could be the reasons for their cautiousness. But though it is prevailing, but the Chinese and the Indian markets are always continue to be the highest ranking emerging market. So it will always continue to draw the investors in a larger amount. So if you see in this pick, the United States holds the first rank in this A.T. Kearney FDI Confidence Index. Actually, the recent in 2018 index list shows the first rank is US, second is Canada, third is Germany, and fourth is UK, and we holds 11th rank. The second article is Karnataka sees 300% jump in FDI inflows. Tamil Nadu also rebounds in the sense it is before it is dipping, but now it is again come back or increase in the FDI inflows. So what the article suggests is RBI recently presented to Parliament the report which states Karnataka government has seen a biggest increase in the FDI last year. It is around 300% increase in the last 12 months, which means March 2016 to March 2017. Similarly, Tamil Nadu is also has seen a major increase of 56% increase in its FDI inflows. But if you see in case of Gujarat, Maharashtra and Andhra Pradesh, there is a drop in the FDI inflows. This is what this RBI reports suggest. So if you see in this pic, this is a trend line. So whatever here, this region is like increase in FDI inflows for those states, and whatever below this trend line is decrease in the inflows. And if you see here, the Bangalore, Chennai, these circles indicate that there is a major increase in the FDI inflows. So if you see in case of sector-wise investment in those FDI, then the computer software and the hardware industry gained a major jump of 68% increase in the FDI. Similarly, the services sector, which always tops the FDI inflows, is remained as in the top position, even though there is a decline in 23% in the inflows of those service sectors. So you can see here, right? I mean, the service sectors holds a major FDI inflows, then the computer hardware and software, then construction, telecommunication, and so on. So the third article is banks agree to resolve the stress reserves quickly. So most of the private and the public sector banks are undergoing problems such as stress reserves or non-performing assets, etc. So before we are having a lot of resolution mechanisms such as joint lenders forum, etc. But now RBI dismantled all those kind of resolution mechanisms. So presently we are having one association which is called one agreement which is called Inter-Creditor Agreement, which is framed under the aegis of Indian Banks Association. So this intercreditor agreement is going to follow or is going to make use of the recommendations which is proposed by Sunil Mehta Committee on the resolution of the stressed asset which is prevailing in the private as well as the public sector banks. So what this ICA in the sense, ICA is an agreement among the banks that is having a lot of stressed assets or non-performing assets in its account. So this pact or this ICA led the banks to formulate some resolution plan in order to solve the non-performing assets which is existing. So under this ICA, what they are going to do is the banks with the highest NPAs or the lenders with the highest stressed assets, they are going to draft this resolution plan. So all other banks or all other lenders are going to give some recommendations or give their point of views on the resolution plan which is made by this major lender. So it is applicable to the lenders who are having a stressed asset in the range of 50 crore to 500 crore category. So if you see here, the 50 crore to 500 crore category lenders are coming under the purview of this ICA. Under this ICA, the resolution plan is now prepared by the major lender. So all other lenders under this ICA now going to give their view whether to accept the resolution plan or not. So if 66% of the lenders under ICA or the 2/3 of the lenders is okay with the resolution plan, then what they are going to do is it is going to be binding on those lenders who are under ICA. As of now, 24 banks including State Bank, Bank of India and Corporation Banks have already signed this ICA. And also majority of the lenders are expected to follow the same suit by the end of this week. And some non-banking financial companies are also going to come on board with this ICA. So this framework, this ICA, which is the intercreditor agreement, is going to be expected to be operational by the end of this month. So the total stress of the public sector banks is estimated to be 10.6 lakh crores. And out of this 10 lakh crores, nearly 2.1 lakh crore is coming under the category of 50 to 500 crore stressed assets. So the next article is stimulus mode on GST rate cuts. So recently, GST Council's 28th meeting was taken place. In that, some new tax rates were being formulated. And under these new rates or whatever the new rates which are formulated by the GST Council recently is going to kick in or going to get implemented from July 27 onward. So what are those new tax rates? If we see, the first one is the consumer durables like washing machines, refrigerators, TVs, all those things are going to get reduced from 28% to 18%. The new tax rates for the environment friendly fuel cell vehicles are also going to get reduced from 28% to 12%. So similarly, semi-precious stones, sanitary napkins, as well as the most labor-intensive fields such as carpets and handicrafts manufacturing, all these things are going to be in the lower tax slabs. So we all know that 0%, 5%, 12%, 18% and 28% tax slabs we are having. So now these things are all coming in the lower tax slabs. But the tobacco, automobiles and cement, all these things are going to be in the higher tax slabs of the GST. So if you see the rate cuts or the new tax rates which are proposed by the GST Council, then you can observe that the rate cuts are largely on the products and services of mass use, which means mostly consumer driven products, major consumer products are coming under the low tax rates. So why? Because it is to stimulus or to encourage the consumption of the consumers. So it also indicates that the government is now comfortable with the revenue which is yielding from the GST. So it also indicates that. So what are the two major concerns here is, now the GST Council is proposing some newer tax rates for certain products. But if some companies couldn't be able to adhere or suddenly change to this new tax rate and continuing under the old tax rate itself, then it is wrongly coming under the ambit of this anti-profiteering action. Then it is obviously going to face the anti-profiteering action against it. So this is a major concern in terms of companies' perspective. This kind of new tax rate changing could also produce a friction between the center and the state. So it is very necessary that the center and the state should work in tandem in order to accomplish or in order to implement this new tax rate in a successful way. So the next article is medical tourists flocking to India. So advanced facilities, skilled doctors, as well as low cost of treatment. All these things made possible that India is a popular hub of medical tourism, which also attracted large number of foreign patients every year into our country. So the Ministry of State for Tourism recently reported that the Bangladesh and the Afghanistan continue to be the top countries where we are receiving a large number of foreign patients. Similarly, these are the countries from which large number of medical tourists or the foreign patients are coming to India every year. So this is some kind of a factual information. So the Ministry of Tourism recently stated about the foreign exchange earned by means of this medical tourism. So how much India earned by means of this medical tourism as well as the foreign patients. So it is, if you see 2016, 17, 18, it is increasing. Similarly, India currently has around 18% of the global medical tourism market. So they are also suggesting or estimating that by 2020, India's medical tourism could account for 20% of the global market share of this medical tourism. So India is being a preferred destination for cardiology, orthopedics, transplants, as well as ophthalmology. So the next article is paddy sowing in East hit by the rain deficit. So the Agriculture Ministry recently report that the paddy sowing is lagging, which means as a country, I mean India as a whole faces a 40% deficit in monsoon rains, so which could lead to the deficit or which could lead to the lagging of the paddy sowing. So majorly 39 large deficit districts are in Bihar and in Uttar Pradesh, mainly because of 60 to 90% shortfall of the monsoon rains in those eastern regions. So the districts, they also suggest that the districts which are seeing 80% deficit or more is going to affect the farmers' income in a very bad shape. So if you see the paddy sowing contribution in Uttar Pradesh, it is like 27 lakh hectares, which is less than 8 lakh hectares than the normal. So similarly, if you see Bihar, it is like 6 lakh hectare only they are cultivating or sowing this paddy, which shows that it is less than half the normal paddy cultivation. So these all indicates that the paddy sowing is deficit or lagging in majorly in eastern states. So the next article is new rules to allow the appeals on NRC. So the Registrar General of India is going to publish the final draft on the NRC list on July 30. So now the center is all set to amend the rules of the Foreigners Tribunal Order 1964. So now the center is planning to amend this act or this order in order to make their residents or the people who are living in the Assam region to file an appeal before the foreign tribunals. So as of now, there are 100 foreign tribunals which are functioning in Assam. So these citizens can go to any of those foreign tribunals and can file the appeal before those foreign tribunals in case their name is not in the list of that NRC draft which is being published on July 30. So under this Foreign Tribunal Order 1964, only the police or the state can move the tribunal if suppose they suspect that an individual staying in Assam is illegal. But now the individual itself can go and file a case or file appeal to the foreign tribunal if suppose their name is not in those NRC list. So that is what the new amendment aims at. So what is the main aim of this NRC draft is to segregate the Indian citizens who are living in the Assam from the people who are illegally entered into India from Bangladesh after March 31st, 1971. So this is the major aim, to segregate the Indian citizens from the Bangladeshi illegal migrants. So the Ministry of Home Affairs recently stated that even though your name is not in the part of the NRC list draft, it does not mean that you are automatically declared as a foreigner. So you are getting or you will get a 1 month window time to claim or to put your case in the foreign tribunals which is existing in Assam, and you can get the remedy as soon as possible via those tribunals. So the next article is government panel to check the cases of mob lynching. So last week, a Muslim dairy farmer was getting lynched by a group of 7 members at Alwar, Rajasthan, when he was transporting his 2 cows and their calves. So similarly, there are a lot of incidences which are happening in our country regarding this suspicion of child lifters or suspicion on protection of cow, etc. So as a means to put an end to these kind of mob lynching or mob violence, the government is now had been constituted this high level committee under the Union Home Secretary. So this high level committee is going to check the cases of the mob lynching which is happening in our country, and they are going to submit the report to the group of ministers which is headed by the Union Home Minister. After that, the final report is being submitted to the Prime Minister. So why? Because the parliament or the government is now condemning these kind of incidents which is happening in the name of mob lynching, because they want to establish the rule of law in our country. So they also suggest that that means the government is now issuing an advisory to the state governments to take the effective measures. Why the state governments? In the sense, we all know that the police as well as the public order, so these are under the state list. So the states have to take care of all these kind of activities which is happening in their own territory. So which means the state government has to control the crimes which is happening. They have to maintain the law and order, and they have to prevent the citizens from these kind of incidences. So that is why the central government is now advising to the state government to take effective measures to prevent these kind of mob lynching or mob violence, as well as to take some proactive steps in order to curb these incidences as per the law. So the next article is India extends 200 million credit lines to Rwanda. So this is the recent news. So it is a one way of India's outreach to the resource rich continent, which is the Africa. So why Rwanda? In the sense, it is the fastest growing economy in the African region, and it is also the gateway for the Indian economy to Africa. So that is why we actually tend to focus on the Rwanda. So this 200 million credit means 100 million for the industrial sectors as well as the Kigali special economic zones, as well as another $100 million is for agricultural sectors. So it is to increase or strengthen the cooperation between the India as well as the Rwanda in terms of trade and agricultural sectors. So not only these kind of trade and agricultural expansion between India and Rwanda, but also the government is planning to establish this high commission in Rwanda for consular or embassy facilities, passport and visa facilities, people who are in Rwanda. So India and Rwanda also signed agreements on leather and allied areas as well as their agricultural research. So our Prime Minister Narendra Modi is also planning to attend this genocide memorial event in Kigali, as well as the Girinka event, which is one cow per family event. So which is a national social security scheme in Rwanda. So Prime Minister is planning to attend these two events. One is genocide memorial as well as this Girinka event.